This is a CBC podcast.
This Sunday, August 1st, is a date that some parts of the world already recognize as Emancipation Day. It was on August 1st in 1834 that slavery was abolished throughout the British Empire, and this year will be the first time Canada officially recognizes the day as a national holiday. Rosemary Sadler is the founder of the Black Canadian Network and the former president of the Ontario Black History Society. She began spearheading the campaign for Canada to recognize Emancipation Day back in 1995. We reached her in Toronto this morning. Rosemary, good morning.
Good morning.
1995, that is more than two decades ago. Can you tell me a little bit about what it's been like trying to get to this point?
It's been a bit of a challenge. I never would have imagined that once I proposed this in 1995 that it wouldn't be until 2021 that we're actually celebrating it across the country. But here we are. And I was lucky initially with the municipal governments and even saw it go to unanimous acceptance in the province of Ontario. But it just has been a challenge nationally for sure. I mean, I started this when contact was through phone calls, in-person, faxes, and actual letter writing, and of course meetings. And but now, even with social media, it's still been a bit of a challenge. Yeah.
And what does it mean to have this date officially commemorated countrywide, as opposed to just a provincial or a municipal event?
Well, I think it's important for us to remember that this is a national phenomenon. Slavery in the lands that we now call Canada existed for over 200 years. So this was the formal enslavement of First Nations, as well as the enslavement of people of African descent. And unfortunately, slavery was abolished through the British Imperial Act in Canada, going into effect August 1st, 1834. But while there was now the end of slavery, the assumed equality didn't really provide the equity for people of African descent, and we could, of course, argue that as well for First Nations. And this is what we are now dealing with. It's an opportunity for us all, because we all have to be part of the solution. So it's an opportunity for us all to be talking about how we can make things better.
I find there's often a bit of a tension, whether it's National Indigenous Peoples Day or Juneteenth, between these events, especially when they happen this summer, where you might have them marked, but for a lot of people, it's just another long weekend or a summer weekend. How do you hope people will mark this Emancipation Day and ones moving forward?
Well, I think, first of all, I think that they should be mindful of all of the days of importance and significance and markings of freedom. But Juneteenth is really kind of the end of the road. Juneteenth marks the end of slavery in the United States, which also marks the end of the need for people to leave the United States to come to Canada to be free on the Underground Railroad. We actually had our freedom first, because Canada's freedom, Canada's abolition of slavery, came on August 1st, 1834, because we were a British colony. And I think it's important to mark these days because it helps bring attention to the reality that there are challenges and disadvantages that impact Black people in particular, more than one might anticipate, perhaps, in education, in employment, in how they are policed, and in healthcare.
Can you talk a little bit more about the ongoing struggle? Yesterday in BC, there was an event where members of the Black community in Vancouver said that they hope the recognition of Emancipation Day will lead to more lasting change. And maybe if you could speak a little bit about what you think that change needs to look like.
Well, I think, you know, let's look at education, for example. We know that Black students might have a higher dropout rate than white or non-Black people because of the systemic barriers they face. That we know that they are often put into applied courses more often than other groups might be. We know that they have reduced success in their jobs and hiring, and that there's a higher unemployment rate in general for the Black community across this country in relation to other people. And if they are so lucky to get into a career, they are restricted in terms of career advancement. So what do we do about that? We hire more Black teachers. We do our training of professions with an anti-Black racism lens in terms of our curriculum and even in terms of our police training. We find ways to, for employers, encourage them to look beyond their traditional quote-unquote Rolodex and expand the opportunity to other people. We also know that there are some examples, like University of Toronto has created a Black student application program, which doesn't mean that people who are unqualified get in, but it does make it more sensitive to the needs of students of African origin, and it has increased the participation and their inclusion significantly since it began in 2017.
It sometimes seems impossible to divorce what's happening to Black Canadians or Black people in Canada from what's happening to Black people in the United States. And that also goes to the extent that many of us don't pay attention to what's happening to Black people in Canada until something happens in the United States. I'm thinking of George Floyd and the Black Lives Matter movements. What can be done to draw more attention to the issues that we have here in our own country without having to wait for something to happen in the United States first?
That's such a good question. And I think, you know, you're right. We kind of wait until there's a crisis. But, you know, just like we've all come to learn about the unmarked graves and the impact that this has had for so many people who it was news to them. But it wasn't news for the First Nations communities. They knew that people were lost and missing, and we as a society didn't believe them and didn't act on that. And I think that it's the same thing in a way in terms of the concerns that the Black community raises. We don't need to have a crisis. We need to be able to listen to the problems, the challenges, the concerns that the Black community has, and in a very real and meaningful way, engage with them and try to be an ally for change rather than maybe denying what you think you're being told or being defensive.
Rosemary, wonderful to speak with you. Thank you so much, and I'm glad that we have had this conversation.
Well, thank you so much, and I hope that you'll be able to be part of Free Up, the Emancipation Day special, which will be at 1 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time on CBC Gem.
That's perfect. CBC Gem, 1 p.m. Eastern. That would be 10 a.m. Pacific. Thank you so much, Rosemary.
Thank you.
Rosemary Sadler is the founder of the Black Canadian Network and the former president of the Ontario Black History Society. Free Up, that Emancipation Day special that she mentioned, is happening on CBC Gem 10 a.m. on Sunday, August 1st. It's going to be a combination of spoken word, poetry, rap music. Again, that's on CBC Gem this Sunday at 10 a.m. Pacific Time.
For more CBC podcasts, go to cbc.ca/podcasts.